Good afternoon. I am Greg Crawford, president of Miami University. We are here today to update everyone on the situation at Miami University regarding two off-campus Miami students being tested for the coronavirus. Miami officials have been working tirelessly with experts and officials from the Ohio Department of Health, ODH, and the Butler County Health District on this matter. We are grateful for their expertise, their advice, their guidance, and their support. And we also are grateful to Governor Mike DeWine and his leadership team for their incredible support and their compassion for our students and campus. I'd like to invite to the podium Dr. Amy Acton, Director of Health of the Ohio Department of Health. Thank you.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. I am Dr. Amy Acton. I have the honor of serving as the Director of Health for our state over our public health system in partnership with our amazing local health departments and statewide hospitals, really being the oversight and the preparedness for our state when it comes to situations like this. We're sort of the mini CDC. I also happen to be a parent of past alum twins from Miami, so I understand what people are feeling today, a lot of the anxiety that might be going around. So first of all, I want to say to you, Ohio, we are on it. We stand prepared. We've been working closely with the CDC for a couple weeks now since the first case. It's really important to know that the CDC is saying at this point that this infection is low risk. So is the World Health Organization. It is a very detailed process we go through. This family of viruses, as you may have followed in the news, is coronavirus. Corona actually means sun, because when you look under the microscope, the virus is shaped as a circle with little spikes. These viruses exist in animals, and we have some human variants of them. Every now and then, what we call zoonotic diseases, these viruses can hop from animal to human. And that's what we believe happened in Wuhan. Past examples of these viruses have been SARS in 2003, MERS in 2015. But at this point, the CDC is still learning. So it is an evolving disease. We don't have all the answers yet. So day by day, we'll be updating everyone as we learn more. But I do want to share what we do know. Again, low risk, respiratory symptoms that look a lot like everything else we're catching right now post-holidays, right? We are looking at difficulty breathing, maybe shortness of breath, a fever. And so what is most important for us to remember is the travel history. That is the key to our investigation. It's a little different than me as a doctor asking the usual symptoms versus our local health department epidemiologists who will be asking exactly where you traveled, what seat did you sit on that train, everything of that detail. So an important thing is early on, this partnership between the university and the local health department is key. We know that it's likely a respiratory illness, and that normal precautions are really all we need to be taking right now. The similar things we do, washing our hands, if you're not feeling good, not going to work, not going to school, coughing into your sleeve, the things we teach. Only with that travel history or with a direct contact with someone who's under investigation are you truly at risk. If someone believes they are at risk for that, you know, travel history, they should call their doctor and they should let them know in advance before going to visit the doctor, because that way the doctor can take the necessary precautions in the waiting room. We think the incubation period can be up to 14 days. And so when we were looking at our state, as sort of the Surgeon General looking at where we would be at risk, we knew that we had two areas of risk in our state. One was we actually have a sister city relationship with Wuhan. So we do have some business travelers, some cargo flights, and that sort of relationship. We also, of course, have our students, our wonderful students that come here to go to school and who may have been at risk. But it could be others. It could be others who traveled. It could be professors. So it really is this travel history that is important. Now, let's talk about the cases here. We do know that we have two students who did travel during that time and had returned home. The university has done an amazing job in student health, working with, again, our local health department to do a good history. And those students are being isolated, meaning it's not a quarantine, but they happen to live independently in a situation where they can stay at home. They're not sick. They don't need hospitalized. What we do is when we do suspect a case, we take respiratory samples as well as blood samples, and those go to the Ohio Department of Health, which then sends them, as we did this morning, to the CDC. Currently, the only place to do the testing is the CDC. The CDC is anticipating it's taking at least 48 hours. It may be longer with the kind of volume they're getting, but that's the turnaround. So we have no confirmed cases in Ohio. We have what we call in our lingo is persons under investigation, so PUIs. So the students are comfortable. And again, what we are recommending, because it's still low risk, is that the rest of the population take normal precautions, your hand washing and monitoring. So I think this is a really, really important time for folks to focus on our website, odh.ohio.gov, where we will be updating everyone with reports to the minute. I'm very, very concerned that we work with our university communities because we don't want fear. We are much more likely to see a disease of contagion of fear than the actual disease. Matter of fact, you're much more likely to get the flu or another cold right now. And as we're seeing that around the country, we have 5 confirmed cases. Again, none in Ohio. So I really want you to know that we stand ready. Ohio is prepared. We drill for this. We have pandemic exercises we do with our hospitals, with our local health departments, with our universities. They prepare for this. So it's really important to listening, you know, to listen to their messaging, because they'll give you good information on what you can do. Let's be kind to students. Again, some students are away from home. It's scary, even just that we all know from our kids, right? Mine are grown now, but we know what it's like when you're scared and you're away at school and you don't feel good. So I just want to make that caution out there to everyone to be thoughtful and sensitive as we, you know, keep you abreast of the latest information. Okay. So I think with that, I would like to share it with our health commissioner, Jenny.
Thank you for coming this afternoon to listen to this overview of the situation here at Miami University in Butler County. I'm Jenny Baylor. I'm the health commissioner for the Butler County General Health District. Butler County Public Health and the entire public health system train and prepare for events such as a possible coronavirus situation every day. This is what we do. We are professionals in public health response and investigation. I have complete confidence in my staff, the public health system, and all of our partners as we work together on this situation. We have been working very closely with Miami University, with TriHealth, with our emergency management agency, and with other local partners, as well as the Ohio Department of Health and the CDC. Persons who are not showing symptoms of respiratory illness do not need to be isolated at this time. We encourage the public to show compassion towards others. The risk of contracting coronavirus, even in this situation, remains very low. We are taking every precaution to keep the community safe and are ready if any cases are confirmed. There are currently no confirmed cases in Butler County, and no additional specimens have been sent for testing by the CDC, except for the 2 persons you already know about who are under investigation. The same precautions that protect against catching and spreading the flu are likely to be helpful for this respiratory virus. Wash your hands regularly. Avoid touching your nose and eyes. Cover your mouth when you cough and sneeze, and don't go to work or school if you feel sick. Any updates to this situation will be posted on our website as well as the Ohio Department of Health and Miami University's websites. Again, displaying compassion to all people will be vital as this situation evolves. And now we will open the floor for questions. And we have specific people who can answer questions in their area of expertise. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Ann Saker from the Inquirer. So I'm not entirely clear on how sick are these two folks? Are they expressing symptoms at this point, or are they asymptomatic and you fear that there may be illness down the road?
Right, so these students are not sick enough to be hospitalized. They did have some symptoms that were concerning to us yesterday. I interviewed them both myself. So they had a combination of some questionable travel locations and some questionable symptoms that made us concerned enough in consultation with the Ohio Department of Health to send some specimens on for testing just to rule out this coronavirus.
What's the process of checking them and how long is it going to take to get back the results?
The process of checking them, you mean what specimens? It is recommended that we draw three specimens. One is a blood draw, one is a nasopharyngeal swab of the nose and the mouth, and the other one is a lower respiratory, a sputum specimen.
And the results from them students, how long will it take?
So we expect the results at the end of the week. As Dr. Acton said, it takes about 48 hours at the CDC, but there is shipping time and paperwork and things as well. So we're saying about a week.
How long have they been back in the United States since they traveled to China?
A few days.
Were they traveling together?
They were.
Did they go to Wuhan?
Not clear.
Do we know if they...
I do not want to answer specific questions about these cases. I'll answer general questions. Okay, I can't tell you about these two people any more than I have.
Can you tell us generally then how this came about? Did they kind of take us through the timeline?
Sure. They came back to Oxford. They were not feeling well. They presented at the Student Health Service. The Student Health Service was well prepared for this. We had talked with them a week and a half ago to say, we need to prepare for an eventual case here. We're going to treat this as if we're going to have one, and we're going to be prepared for it. So they knew exactly what to do. They isolated the students immediately and called us, and then we did an investigation, interviewed the students, and then placed them in a home situation because they were not sick enough to be hospitalized. They will stay in their homes and not be out in the public at all this week.
I'm not asking for you to say specifically where they're located, but I have heard from concerns from folks in like the Hamilton area. I know there are apartment buildings who house a lot of these international students and they commute to Oxford. Can you say like what general area in Butler County they're located in?
No.
Can you confirm if they live in a house or an apartment complex?
No.
Would you be willing to go as far as to say if there's anybody, excuse me, on campus that's not feeling well to seek medical attention?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that?
Would you be willing to stress to individuals who don't feel well, who may have come from different parts of the country who don't feel well, stress them to seek medical attention?
Sure, it's always a good idea if you don't feel well to call your provider. I would stress that people should not just appear at an urgent care or student health or a doctor's office if they have had a travel history to China. They need to call ahead and say that that is the situation and ask for the procedure, and the provider will help them enter the building through a back entrance or go immediately to an isolation room. And remember, you can ask questions of the Ohio Department of Health or Miami University, or we have Dr. Stephen Blatt is an infectious disease expert with TriHealth, and he can answer questions as well. Yes.
Have you guys confirmed which airports they traveled to? Are these airports taking any extra precautions?
We have confirmed their complete travel itinerary, yes.
Can you share that?
No.
Do you believe it's time, or would there be a time where you would consider testing all international students just for safety's sake, theirs and the rest of the community?
At this time, that is not at all recommended. Persons without symptoms are not being recommended for treatment or pre-screening or anything like that. But this is a great question for Dr. Acton or Dr. Blatt.
Okay.
We will definitely continue to monitor this with the CDC, but definitely not at this time. And back to your airport question, you know, we do have 5 ports of entry. The CDC is on a level 3 travel alert, and so they're routing through those airports.
Have you been in touch with anybody who these students have been in touch with since they've gotten back to the United States?
I can answer that. So fortunately, they didn't do much in the way of being in contact with other people. So we do know exactly who they've been in contact with, but it's a very, very small number.
If you had known about this, actually, this question is for you, so you can step back up.
Yes, sir.
So apparently, they called from China and said that I'm showing these symptoms and I'm coming to the U.S. or no?
No.
So no. The first that you heard about this was yesterday when they
Correct.
Showed up.
Correct. Correct.
Do you recommend students wearing masks?
Generally, no.
No.
No. Absolutely not.
Do we know if these students were international students who are from China, or are they domestic students who were traveling in China during our J term, whatever it is?
They are people who traveled to China.
Anything more specific?
No.
Okay.
So Jenny, are they Oxford, Ohio students? Or do they go to the branch campus?
No, they're Oxford, Miami Oxford okay. students, yes.
Dr. Croft, can you talk about the basketball games?
Yeah. Yeah, the men's and women's basketball game, there's a men's basketball game tonight and the women's basketball game tomorrow night, and the games have been canceled and have been rescheduled.
Is that by Miami University?
No, not by Miami University.
So wait, have they been, I'm sorry, can you go back into that?
Yep.
So have they been canceled because of this?
I believe so, yes.
So who made that decision?
We let the schools do it, and they were in contact with the MAC commissioner and the ADs.
Do you agree with that decision?
It's up to that school in particular, yes.
What percentage of international students are there at Miami? Do you know?
Let me ask Jane to give that number. Percentage of international students?
But
18%? I know what it was last year.
Yeah.
I don't know if I know off the top of my head.
Wait, give me one second. So were these international students, or were these Americans from other states, or can you give us a description to that degree?
We've identified one of the students as an international student, identified the friend.
Okay. Do you have their ages?
No, I don't have that.
I'm Jane Brownell, I'm Vice President for Student Life, and one of our students is going online for our fast facts about international students. I know what it was last year in terms of general percentage, but I don't know what our shift was this year.
Wait, so how about just round numbers of Miami undergrad student population and undergrad international student population?
So our overall undergraduate population is about 17,000 in Oxford. We have about another 2,500 graduate students. Our international student body is about 10%, but that could be give or take a couple of percent of what it is this year.
Now, I know that obviously there are a lot of students from China who attend Miami University. Mm-hmm. Was there any plan in place, knowing that this virus was out there, that a lot of them would be traveling over the break and returning possibly this past weekend or this past week?
So I want to look to our Department of Health people, but at the time that we left in December, this was not really on the radar screen. So this has come up more recently than that. We certainly have been in touch with all of our international students while they were away to get a sense of where they were, make sure that they could come back for class, get a sense of just what their travel history was. So we were reaching out because we were hearing from a few students who couldn't make it back for class, and so trying to assist them as well.
Dr. Acton, are there any other cases in the state of Ohio that you guys are looking at as
There are no cases and no persons under investigation, so neither at this that I'm knowledgeable of at this point. And I just want to say all universities have plans. We have a whole emergency preparedness system. So, you know, I sit on a group of incredible scientists who are infectious disease specialists and epidemiologists. We also have emergency preparedness. And so your hospitals, we all work as a network. It was one of the benefits post, 9/11 is that we have built up quite a system. So all universities, I was on the phone with all the presidents today talking about that. And so we do have these plans in place when there is an infectious disease.
Dr.
Dr. Acton, or... The CDC is the only place where this right now can be tested. Are there any plans being made to have state testing centers around the country?
Yes, yes, and they're in that work. They think it's about 2 to 3 weeks out at this point. So, you know, the type of test was basically invented a polymerase reaction that it can test based on the strain of the virus as it was detected. So it's really important to know that we're learning more about this virus daily.
How deadly is this, or is it deadly? What do we know about it? Like, is it, we're really all, you know, scared, but...
Sorry, I'm stepping over the box here. So, you know, we're still learning. Now, we know, just like with the flu, believe me, many, many more people will die in our state from the flu. We had a, you know, a young person die not too long ago. If you are immunocompromised, if you're elderly, and that seems to be at least some of the initial trends we're seeing in China, you're more likely to succumb from any virus. You know, there's good indication that healthy young people will be healthy, but we're still learning, and that's what's interesting about these novel viruses.
Are the different strains, or is this novel?
Yeah, it's novel, meaning new, okay. Right? And so these things, viruses are smart, they morph, and... you know, and again, the issue of zoonotic diseases, that's why we have a surveillance system. That's why investing in public health and keeping that, you know, top-notch is really important, because that is our barrier. It's there 24/7 protecting you. You just don't know about it. It's constantly on the alert. So,
what's going to be the course of action if you get the test back and they do test positive for coronavirus?
Then we are already working with contacts, but, you know, we will do supportive measures. The treatment is supportive at this point. There are antivirals, and certainly I'll allow our infectious disease specialist to speak to that a little bit more, but we would treat. Right now, we're already, you know, in our epidemiology, we look for all possible contacts, and we work out in rings from there, so that's the disease detective work.
Are they getting any type of treatment at the moment, or are they just by themselves?
Supportive.
What does that mean?
Meaning, you know, medicine for a fever, eating, sleeping, the usual things you would do for a virus.
I was going to ask, how ill are they today? Has anyone checked on them? Are they?
Yeah.
Do they have a fever? Are they feeling like they have, that they're sick?
They are feeling fairly well today.
And can you clarify, because it says in Miami's letter one student presented, but we're saying like they're both having symptoms. So can you say, did they both have symptoms?
Yes. So initially, we thought that there were two students who traveled together who were both sick, and so we said we had two persons under investigation. Then as we delved into their travel history and their symptoms a little bit further, we found that there was one primary who is a person under investigation, and the second person, technically, if you want to get technical, is actually a contact of the first one. Okay?
That second person traveled to or from China?
They traveled together.
You guys were emphasizing compassion and things like that before. Are you guys worried that there's going to be like an anti-Chinese sentiment or anti-international student sentiment that might result from this?
I think that is something we always have to be vigilant about. I think when fear takes over, when, again, fear drives us, it's really important to know the basic facts as we know them. Certainly folks being cautious, taking regular precautions against getting ill if someone near you is sick, you know, washing your hands, the same things we would do every day, but there's no reason at this point. Again, CDC is saying it is low risk in this country. So we really want to, like all folks, be compassionate about people who are not feeling well.
How easily does it spread?
You know, that they're still learning a lot more about it. They are saying at this point a 6-foot range. It's typical respiratory spread is believed, but again, the CDC is still learning more. Like lots of viruses, you always wonder about when someone's feeling asymptomatic, the period before they first start showing symptoms, very similar to other viruses.
Are you concerned this might spread to other universities across Ohio, or there might be other cases?
We are vigilant for cases all over Ohio. As I said, you know, we're particularly paying attention to perhaps business travelers. Maybe people remember this was the Chinese Lunar New Year, one of the biggest human migrations that goes on. Whenever there's a mass movement of people, you know, disease spread is always something we're on the lookout for, so.
Just a question for the university. Are there, so the games have been canceled. Is there anything else that's specifically the university is doing at this point, or what's the plan there?
So we are following all of the CDC and Department of Health guidelines is the first thing. We are in touch multiple times a day. We are following up with health messaging to students in the residence halls, in classes. We have our we have a health column on our internal website that we're continuing to update. We're updating parents. As has been repeated today, what is needed is the regular health precautions that you would take during flu season at this time of year. So those are the precautions that we are doing, is making sure that people, it is the start of the semester. If you are not feeling well, stay home. We are asking faculty to be flexible with that, that don't encourage students to come to class if they're not feeling well. So it is those basic kind of common sense winter health guidelines.
And at this point, you don't anticipate, you know, like these games were canceled by other schools, you don't anticipate canceling on-campus activities, classes, anything like that?
Not at this time.
I'm sorry, I wonder if you could say your name and title one more time.
Sure. Please. Jane, and I'll spell that J-A-Y-N-E, Brownell, and I'm Vice President for Student Life.
Thank you.
Can you spell your last name?
B-R-O-W-N-E-L-L.
Thank you.
I wonder if I could get one question from the infectious disease doc. Thank you, Doctor. Have you had a chance yourself to take a look at this thing under the microscope and get a...
So,
learn about it yourself?
Yeah, I'm Dr. Stephen Blatt, B-L-A-T-T, from TriHealth. I'm the medical director for infectious diseases. You know, I've seen photographs or photomicrographs of the virus. I personally haven't seen it myself because it, you know, as far as we know, isn't even here yet. There are only 5 cases identified in the U.S. so far. We have plans in place, you know, for our hospital system should patients become ill, to put patients in isolation and provide whatever medical care they need. We currently don't have any antiviral drugs for coronavirus, but for other viruses we do. So I think it's important if people become ill with a viral-like illness that they get tested. We certainly have good treatment for influenza or flu. So many of these cases that are tested for coronavirus actually end up having the flu, and they can be treated for that to help them get better more quickly. I think it's important to know that most of the people who've been tested for coronavirus have had something else. It's still very uncommon, especially in the United States. Even in China, lots of the cases have had something other than coronavirus.
Thank you.
We got data for somebody who asked that they...